Throughout the book so far, Marx has mainly been dealing with capitalism's formation and early capitalist attempts at gaining profits by extending the period of the working day and the coercion of turning people into a labour force. From this part onwards, however, Marx will now begin to take us directly into the dark heart of capitalist production, its thirst for profit, and how it functions as a totality, and what drives the system and the participation of everyone involved. That portion of the working day, which merely produces an equivalent for the value paid by the capitalist for his labour power, has, up to this point, been treated by us as a constant magnitude, and such in fact it is, under given conditions of production and at a given stage in the economic development of society. Beyond this, his necessary labour time, the labourer we saw, could continue to work for 2, 3, 4, 6, etc. hours. The rate of surplus value and the length of the working day depended on the magnitude of this prolongation. In part 3, we saw how the working day is essentially split into two sections, which Marx represented on a line from A to B and B to C. That part of the working day where the labourer is reproducing their own labour power, or necessary labour, and that part of the day where they are producing surplus value for the capitalist, or surplus labour, A to B, B to C. Marx refers to this process as the creation of absolute surplus value. We also saw, however, that this process of absolute surplus value has limits for capitalist production, in both the length of the working day and the amount of labourers employed or in society. In this chapter, Marx now highlights a different process of obtaining surplus value, and one that is potentially limitless, that of relative surplus value. The prolongation of the surplus labour would correspond to a shortening of the necessary labour, or a portion of the labour time previously consumed, in reality, for the labourer's own benefit, would be converted into labour time for the benefit of the capitalist. There would be an alteration, not in the length of the working day, but in its division into necessary labour time and surplus labour time. If we now assume that the total length of the working day is fixed, for example at 10 hours, and we'll represent this on a line from A to C, Marx highlights that it's also possible to increase the time spent producing surplus value by decreasing the amount of time the labourer spends reproducing their labour power. For example, A to B 5 hours, B to C 5 hours could be made into A to B 4 hours, B to C 6 hours, or A to B 3 hours, B to C 7 hours, etc, etc. Marx first points out that this could be done by simply reducing the wages paid to the labourers to below the value of their labour power. While we know from real life examples that this absolutely does happen all over the world, Marx, however, points out that this is not self-sustaining. If labourers were paid less than their ability to reproduce themselves, eventually their labour power would suffer and collapse, meaning their ability to perform surplus labour for the capitalist would also be reduced. Essentially, labourers would not be able to earn their living, and it would be counterproductive to capitalism's growth. We must also remember that, again, Marx is dealing with a perfectly functioning capitalist system, and will continue to assume that labour power is bought and sold at its full value. He now points out that there is only one other way that this reduction in A to B is possible, by reducing the value of labour power itself. It follows that the labour time necessary for the production of labour power, or for the reproduction of its value, cannot be lessened by a fall in the labourer's wages below the value of his labour power, but only by a fall in this value itself. Given the length of the working day, the prolongation of the surplus labour must of necessity originate in the curtailment of the necessary labour time. The latter cannot arise from the former. What this means is that capitalism must decrease the value of labour power without reducing the ability for workers to reproduce themselves as workers. To do this, the value of commodities directly must be decreased. The value of food, clothing, tools, all the means of subsistence that allow the workers to reproduce their labour power must be decreased. in effect reducing the value of their labour power. The only way this is possible, and a subject I briefly mentioned in Chapter 1, is an increase in productivity. Such a fall in the value of labour power implies, however, that the same necessaries of life, which were formerly produced in 10 hours, can now be produced in 9 hours. But this is impossible without an increase in the productiveness of labour. For example, suppose a shoemaker, with given tools, makes in one working day of 12 hours one pair of boots. If he must make two pairs in the same time, the productiveness of his labour must be doubled, and this cannot be done except by an alteration in his tools or his modes of working, or in both. Hence the conditions of production, i.e. his mode of production, and the labour process itself, must be revolutionised. Let's imagine our hats again, and say that a capitalist has our worker make 10 hats a day, one an hour over a 10-hour workday. We'll say the value of a finished hat is £10. £7 is the value of the constant capital, or cotton, embodied within the hat, and £3 is the new value added by labour power. Now let's imagine that the capitalist somehow doubles productivity, making our worker now produce 2 hats an hour, or 20 in a 10-hour workday. The time it takes to produce a hat has decreased by half, and so the new value added by labour power also decreases by half. The capitalist now ends the day with 20 hats, with the finished value of £8.50 each, £7 constant capital, and £1.50 from the labour power. If we understand that the value of commodities are determined by the socially necessary labour time it takes for their production, then a society-wide increase of productivity, decreasing the amount of necessary time it takes to produce them, will decrease the value of those commodities. We also understand that the value of labour power is the socially necessary labour time it takes to reproduce itself. Then a decrease in the value of commodities needed for labour power's self-reproduction is a direct decrease in the value of labour power. For this to happen, increased productivity must occur in two branches of industry. Firstly, those industries that are producing commodities that are directly consumed by the labourers. Food, clothing, medicine, goods for education and relaxation. All the commodities we need in our day-to-day lives for reproducing ourselves as labourers. Secondly, those branches of industry that provide the raw materials and tools to the first branches of industry. The cotton industry that provides the cotton for our hat or cloth makers. The leather industry that provides the leather to our football makers. The steel industry that provides the metal for the hat-making tool, or the farmers that produce the raw food that is processed in food production industries. All these places have a direct relationship on the value of the commodities we consume, and an increase in productivity in any of these production processes has the combined effect of reducing the value of labour power. Whenever an individual capitalist cheapens shirts, for instance, by increasing the productiveness of labour, he by no means necessarily aims at reducing the value of labour power and shortening pro tanto the necessary labour time. But it is only insofar as he ultimately contributes to this result that he assists in raising the general rate of surplus value. Marx now finally arrives at the driving force behind capitalism, the coercive laws of competition. Individual capitalists do not have some conscious plan to decrease the necessary labour time on a large social scale, but their individual attempts to increase productivity within their own factories has a culminating effect as a total system. Let us return to our previous example of the capitalist who, after increasing productivity, has just started producing 20 hats a day instead of 10. The capitalist now meets the market with a product that has a value £1.50 cheaper than any other hat-making capitalists. They could choose to sell it above this value, yet still below the social average of £10 per hat, let's say £9.50. Not only that, but they are also now producing twice as many hats in a day as anyone else. So our capitalist now commands a larger share of the hat-making market, and any competition simply cannot compete. This expanding supply and the pushing down of prices threatens other capitalists' profit and their market share. Under this pressure, other hat producers must adapt and apply similar ways of increasing the productivity of their workforce. Eventually, over time, all hat-producing capitalists average out, making 20 hats a day. Due to this new social average, the value of hats across the market now falls to £8.50 instead of £10, and the market now produces twice as many hats, meaning twice as much demand must now be found. Twice as many people must now actually want to buy a hat. Our original capitalist, however, has now lost the advantage that they initially had over the market, and collectively, the necessary labour time for hat production has been halved on a society-wide scale, which in turn incrementally lowers the value of labour power, increasing the overall amount of surplus labour for the capitalist class as a whole. Our capitalists now, in an effort to again make a profit and get ahead of the other capitalists, must find new ways of increasing productivity of their labour force, starting the cycle all over again. What we see is that under capitalism, this free market isn't free at all. The driving force of competition not only means the working class must be forced into capitalist production for their survival, but even the capitalists themselves are not free from this coercive force of capitalism, where even they must compete or perish. Simply put, capitalists always need more money or profit than they started with to continue to produce and reproduce themselves and their business. To do so, they must constantly compete against other capitalists by increasing productivity of their labour force to get ahead for a period of time. They either compete or they fail to make a profit. This constant competition between the collective capitalist class as a whole is the force or invisible hand that drives capitalism on and on and on, while further increasing productivity of the labour force continually. The shortening of the working day is therefore by no means what is aimed at in capitalist production when labour is economised by increasing its productiveness. It is only the shortening of the labour time necessary for production of a definite quantity of commodities that is aimed at. The fact that the workman, when the productiveness of his labour has been increased, produces, say, 10 times as many commodities as before, and thus spends 1/10 as much labour time on each, by no means prevents him from continuing to work for 12 hours as before, nor from producing in those 12 hours 1,200 articles instead of 120. One final point that Marx mentions is that while the increase of productivity allows the labour force to produce a vast increased amounts of commodities than previously before, capitalism by no means desires a shortening of the amount of time people are actually at work. This might be something for you to think about the next time that you're in a supermarket, providing you with a huge variety of cheap food, clothing, and electrical products, which on the surface appears as if you live in a society of social wealth. Yet the labour force is working more and more hours than ever before, while never really obtaining any actual gain in that wealth, and millions of unwanted products sit in warehouses or landfills.